Culmination of prayer.
Leave it to Bob.
It's a good segue, actually, because the word of God is free. Everything that Christ provided for us is free. We don't have to pay for it. We can't earn it. We can't work our way toward it. We can't become better people to get it. Jesus came when we were like without our strength, without any. We were on the wrong side of the wrong side.
That's right.
We were in a bad place, worse than the bad place that we even think in our minds. It was just totally hopeless. And you know what? God recognized us, the place we were in, the hole that we were in, deeply in, and he sent his son. And so this for me starts at the cross. It starts with the fact that Jesus Christ came and died for my sin. Yes. If you're a believer in this room, you understand what that means. It means that all that your mistakes, all of your bad decisions, everything, and I'm talking past stuff, talking present stuff, I'm talking future stuff that's going to happen, because it's going to happen. I'm not advocating sin, but I am saying that we are sinners. We're saved by the grace of God. So, in a sense, I recognize my sinfulness, but I also recognize the righteousness and the holiness of a great God who has given me his spirit so that I can live out that same righteousness and that same holiness, not in my own strength, but in the strength of him. And so tonight, just coming here, like, so step two, it's February, so like for me, I've worked out this thing. Some of you may be doing it as well. So you have 12 months in a year, so you have a month to do a step. So January was step one. For me, February is step two. And then like if you have the devotional, then you've got 31 days to do step two, and there's like a different devotion every time. I guess what I'm saying is that we are in a place, because we're in our addiction or out of our addiction or whatever it looks like, that we have to work our recovery. But our recovery can't be done without the other thing, which is our faith. So when I speak and when I talk about it, it's recovery and faith. Because they work together. It's like and is a conjunction, and the thing that's in front of it is just as important as the thing that is behind it. So you can't work your recovery without working your faith. You can't do it. And if you're working your faith, you're already working your recovery. And that's what it looks like, because for real, the only reason why we're able to stand at all is because of the grace and the goodness of God.
Amen.
And you got to know that. We didn't have this. Listen, we have tried. I don't know about you. Stuff still trying to do and wanting to escape some stuff and be free of some stuff. And don't understand why I'm a believer now and still that person, and I'm talking about in terms of the thing, knows my name and will follow me and will taunt me and will try to seduce me. And I'm saying, God, what the heck? You said I'm a new creature, and we are. But we're in this world, and we're going to have to deal with some stuff. We've had friends that have gone back, and I don't get despondent as much as I used to about people that go back, because I know God is married to the backslider. And I know that he's not willing that anybody should perish. And so he comes after us tenaciously, and I want you to know that his love for us is so great that he doesn't forget who you are. No matter what you're doing, no matter what you've done, no matter what in your mind you think you're going to do, God is saying, but I know you, and you belong to me. And so what he wants us to understand is once you belong to him, that's it. I've got five kids. Five. We're in relationship because I'm their dad and they're my kids. Now, we're in fellowship based on how they act or how I act. The relationship does not change. I'm saying that for a reason, because a lot of people think that if I do something wrong or if I fall too short, then God doesn't want me anymore. And that's so far from the truth. And I guess I really want to emphasize that tonight, that no matter where you are, no matter what you've done or who you've done, the Lord wants you.
Amen.
The Lord loves you. That he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him will not perish. John 3:16. Really important verse. That's the gospel. The next verse actually is just as important. He says, Jesus, I didn't come to condemn you. We were walking around in condemnation and regret. We're walking around with poor self-image and self-worth. And you know what? It's, you know, that is what it is, because my worth in myself is nothing. But when he has made me worthy, then it is something. He didn't come into this world to condemn me, but he says that because he came, I can be saved. I can be made new. If I allow the Holy Spirit of God, so we got the Trinity here, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. If I allow that Spirit, his Spirit, which is not a force. We're not talking Star Wars. You know, we're not talking some power to woo-woo. We're not talking, we're talking about the person of the Holy Spirit who comes and lives on the inside of us. When you accept Jesus as your Savior, when you say, Lord, I want you to come in. It's messy here, but I got to open the door. You got to come in because without you, I can do nothing. I've tried. And if that's not enough, I've messed up other people while I've been trying. I need you to come in and fix this. I want to read you something, and I'm going to go to the Word because I love the Word. But I've been told I have limited time tonight, so I'm going to do this real quick. But I won't read all of John chapter 17, but I will say to you, I love the book of John. Jesus proclaims who he is, and it talks about his desire for each one of us, right? But I'm going to have a couple verses in John 17, because that's Jesus' prayer. The Lord's prayer is not our Father, which art in heaven. That's a prayer he taught us. But you want to find how he prayed, you read John chapter 17. So just kind of keep that mental note. But let me read this to you. It says this. As we explore the many beautiful, and listen to this word, because it's very important to know how our Father cares for us, the many beautiful and intimate ways Jesus comes to heal our inner being. Keep in mind that whatever the damage may be in any realm of your inner being, the essence of healing prayer is always to facilitate the presence of Jesus into specific places of damage. Whatever else might be involved, it always begins with Jesus, come into this and heal me.
Amen.
Now, I don't know about you, but there's been a lot of brokenness in my life. I don't know about you, the experiences you may have had. I would think, just looking at some of the faces, and not because you look terrible, but you know what, in the spirit, pain kind of shows up, and you can just see people have gone through some stuff. Well, I want you to know Jesus is a healer.
Amen.
Amen.
I'm not just talking about physical healing, but I'm talking about emotional healing. I'm talking about when he gives us a mental healing, because some of us have been downright crazy.
Amen.
Out of our minds.
Yep.
And it wasn't just because of the meth.
Everything.
Some of us were just crazy.
Yep.
The meth is kind of like accented all that, but the bottom line is the only clarity of mind comes when you get to know your Creator. And I want to say this because you want to be more than just a creative being. You want to be a redeemed being.
Yes.
It's more than just being created by God. Everybody's been created by God. But not everybody has been redeemed by God. And it's not because he doesn't want to. It's because they haven't received. They don't want anything to do with them. When I talk about the spirit and we talk about being spiritual and the rooms you go to and they say, well, I don't believe that God stuff, but I'm a spiritual person. It's impossible. Because the Holy Spirit is the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And so in order to be a spiritual man, according to the Word of God, you have to know the Holy Spirit. That other spirit you can go buy at the store. Wines and spirits, I've seen that too. I don't want anything to do with that. Really important. Let me finish this. Oswald Chambers, I don't know whether you, like, he wrote some good devotionals, and he emphasized a lot about prayer. And let me say something about prayer. You got to know this. I've been telling the guys this, too. You got to just be yourself with God. You be transparent in your prayer life because you're having a conversation with your dad. When my kids come to me, I don't want them to say, oh, most reverend dad. Dad. Some of them get smart. Michael. No. You can't call me Michael. You're my son. But what I'm saying is there's a relationship which begets a fellowship. And there's a place where they can come where maybe some of the kids in the neighborhood can't come.
Right.
So the Father is saying to us, I love you with an everlasting love. And I'm drawing you to myself by my loving kindness. And I want to talk with you. Isaiah 1:17. Come on. Let us reason together. I'll listen to all your mess. I know it already. But I want to talk about it with you. Come on. And it's even though your sins be as scarlet, I'll make them as white as snow. Because the blood covers it all. I gotta say it. The cross, and we love this song. My wife and I are, like, it's the thing in the room. She'll be singing it in a mile, I'll pick it up. But it says the cross has the final word.
Amen.
There's something about that. There's something about that. No matter what the naysayers are doing, no matter what the enemy is taunting you with, no matter what even your flesh is trying to drive you at, the cross has the final word. That's why Jesus said, it is finished. It's done.
Amen.
Nothing else needs to be accomplished to get you connected with God. Jesus handled that. So let's walk in what Jesus already provided.
Amen.
Amen.
Come on, y'all. We need to walk in what Jesus has already provided for us. Just connect with the Father. Let's acknowledge that Jesus Christ, my elder brother, has handled every enemy that could ever come. And when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Bible says the Lord raises up a standard against him. No weapon formed, the Bible says. No weapon formed. Didn't say it would not be formed, but no weapon formed will be able to prosper because of who my dad is.
Amen.
I've got to learn that. And seriously, when I read the big book and I look at what the influence is, it's the book of James, Matthew chapter 5, the Beatitudes. You really got to look at that and understand what it really is about working recovery. We got to be serious. Mm-hmm. If you're playing games and you're just there and there, look at this. All right, so I always refer to this again, but I talk to guys that are in recovery houses. If you're just there so you want to get off the street for the winter, so you can kind of build a fence to go back out in the street, you're wasting your time.
Amen.
And you're wasting your life. But God has called you, even if you're in a recovery house and you don't like where you are, but you're in a safer place than you are in the street. And it gives you an opportunity, especially in a meeting like this, to meet Jesus. And every man or woman that has an encounter with him, he changes.
Amen.
There's going to be a change. Can't help it. Because in him is life.
Amen.
And when life, especially his life, he's got the resurrection life. So when your dead self gets in contact with him, guess what has to happen? He touched a funeral buyer, says that the son was dead. All he did was touch it. And the boy was brought back to life. Or Lazarus, who was dead for 4 days, all he did was speak to, listen, Lazarus, come on out of there. If he can do all of that, he can speak to our dead areas and say, look, come on back to life. Because Jesus said, I've come to give you life, because you might have life more abundantly. Life and more abundant life. Let me finish this. Oswald Chambers, a man who wrote profoundly and elegantly on prayer, made a radical statement when he said this. The idea of prayer is not in order to get answers from God. Good heavens, not? What? Wait, really? Well, what then is the purpose? Prayer is perfect and complete oneness with God. Now let me go quickly to John 17, verse 3. Because here's what Jesus is saying. Like this, all this here is summed up in these verses here, right? So when I go to John 17, 3, this is what Jesus said. This is life eternal. If you're a believer in this room, you already have eternal life. We think we're waiting for heaven. But you already got it. You're living eternally. Death is only a passageway for us. It's not a sorrowful place, although it can be sad to lose someone loved. But if they know Christ, they've gone on to be with him. Jesus said, I'm going to prepare a place that where I am, you're going to be with me. He's waiting for us to come home. And if the rapture comes, he's going to come and get us before the death happens. But whatever the thing is, we're going to be with the Lord. To be absent from this body is to be present with the Lord. So there's a different kind of hope now. The stuff in this life doesn't have to dominate me and destroy me because this life is not the end. A pregnant woman, and some of you women have been pregnant and have kids, right?
Yeah.
All right, so you go through that. The baby's safe inside your body, right? And usually it's about 9 months. Sometimes it's been earlier. But for about 9 months, you got this baby inside. You know, and from the baby's perspective now I'm going to speak. Happy, I'm being fed, I'm warm, my mom is keeping me, and sometimes dad is around and he rubs the belly. I may or may not like his voice, but I love mom's voice. I love what she does. She's keeping me safe. And something happens at the end of 9 months, not because the baby wants it to happen. And some of you don't want it to happen when it's happening. But it's going to happen.
Yeah.
And so at the end of 9 months, the baby has to come out. So when I look at that, it's like God gives a picture of, you know what? You're in this life right now, and there are birth pains, and there's stuff that's going to go on that is going to be hard. But you're not staying. You're going to be birthed out of here. And we're going to be forever with the Lord. John 17, 3. This is life eternal, that they might know thee. Remember I said the word intimate? The word know is an intimate word. In the book of Genesis, it says Adam knew. That's a derivative of the word to know, right? Adam knew Eve, and she conceived and had a baby. There was fruit. There was life. Well, guess what? When you get to know the Lord, there's fruit. Read Galatians 5. It talks about the fruit of the Spirit. What's something happening in us? That's because of an intimacy that we have with him, provided by him at the cross. But nevertheless, we continue to yield ourselves or surrender ourselves to the true Holy Spirit of God. I'm saying that because, again, it's not some force out there. The Holy Spirit comes and lives in here. Jesus said the Holy Spirit will not only be with you, but he's going to live inside you. He also said, if you abide in me and my word abides in you. So it's talking about something that's going on that's beyond our ability to kind of like figure it out in a natural sense. But it's something that God reveals to us. And by faith, we grab hold to the fact that I'm born again because of the Spirit of God who is working on the inside.
Amen.
And because of the cross that happened. And I don't do anything else but grab hold to the cross. I grab hold to the life of Jesus. I get Philippians 2:5 and I say, let this mind be in me, which was also in Christ Jesus. The word is full of things that we can do. I know, 5 minutes. As we're walking with the Lord, we're on this journey, right? Let me finish this. It says this. Prayer is perfect and complete oneness with God. A mighty truth is being uncovered here. Oneness with God is the goal of our existence. It's not merely to believe in God, although that is better than not believing in him. It is not merely to trust in God, though that is far better than simply believing in God. It is not even to worship God, which is higher still. The destiny of the human soul is union with God. Now let me read these two verses. Verse 11, same chapter, right? And now, Jesus is talking to his Father. I am no more in the world, but these are still in the world. And I'm coming to you, Father, but keep through your name those whom you have given to me, that they may be one or in union as I am with you. You go to verse 21, he says this, that they may be one as thou, Father, art in me, and I'm in you, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that you've sent me. And the glory which you've given me, I've given to them, that they may be one, even as we are one. I in them, thou in me, that they may be perfect in one. And that the world may know that that you have sent me, and you've loved them as you've loved me. Let me finish this. The destiny of the human soul is union with God. The same oneness that Jesus talked about with his Father is our destiny as well. That's what we were made for. Prayer is one of his primary means of doing it, drawing us to himself, getting us to pour out our hearts before him so that we can receive his heart toward us. Again, Philippians 2:5 says this, let this mind be in you. Here's your portion. I've got to allow God to do a work in me. Some of us are fighting it. Some of us are not ready to lay down the party because the party has provided certain things. Some of us are still not sure that we can trust in this thing because we've been let down by so many other things before. But the Bible says that God is faithful and his mercies are new every morning. He's a God that's full of compassion. Your heart is beating, and you are breathing right now, not on your own dime. If you had to do it on your own, you'd never be able to sleep, because you'd be worried about, seriously, if I had to worry about keeping my heart going, I would never fall asleep. But just as we're able to take advantage of the goodness of God in the physical, let us begin to walk in the truth of God in the Spirit.
Amen.
Because as you walk in the Spirit, you will not fulfill, you will not be dominated by, you will not be destroyed by the lust of the flesh.
Amen.
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 Amen. Amen. Was that good?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. I want to pray tonight about cravings. Before I came here tonight, I said, Lord, you know, we need to pray. Because there are cravings that are going on, and they're not less real just because you're a believer. They are very real.
Amen.
But the Bible says there's no temptation taken you but such as is common to man. But God is faithful. He won't allow you to be tempted above that which you're able. But along with that temptation, that craving, he will make a way of escape.
Amen.
That you'll be able to bear it. I'll get personal. Sometimes I'm tempted to do the wrong thing, and the phone rings out of nowhere. That's a way of escape.
1 Corinthians 10:13.
That's right. This boy has the Bible in his mouth. The word is hidden in his heart, right? So let's pray, and then we're gonna let our brother come up and do his thing.
Amen.
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 I
I just want to thank God for my class.
Amen.
Yes. Yes.
But here's the deal. So I've been doing ministry with him for 20 years, this year. And God has just given us just wonderful men and women in this ministry that know how to share his word, that are intimate with him. And the way that he expresses that is true to them. And he shows that there's an intimacy between him and God. Amen?
Amen.
And that's what God wants with every one of us.
Right.
Yes.
Is that intimacy.
I just want to pray for that. So whatever that thing is, just close our eyes. Just close our eyes. Because you know the thing that's really been tugging at you this week. And it may be that it's coming out of nowhere, you think. But the enemy is the enemy. So I just want to pray. Father, there is a thing going on. The enemy is seeking to steal, kill, and destroy. But Jesus, we have to stand on the truth that you said in your word that you come that we might have life and have it more abundantly. You said that we can cast all our cares upon you because you care for us. But you tell us, God, that you are the one that is greater in us than the thing that's in the world. So we're coming to you because the craving is too big for me. But you said, submit myself unto you and then resist the devil. The devil runs. And I know that the devil's not running from me, but he's running from the Christ in me, Lord God. Father, help us to stand in the truth of your word. The cross does have the final word. And so whatever that thing is, we're just releasing it to Jesus Christ. We need your presence, Lord. We need your power. You provide a way, God. You always make a way, God. You always make a way for your kids. And we're looking to you. You're the only answer. You are the answer. You are our recovery. So we honor you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you all.
Bravo.